Hello, welcome to my talk. I'm Shan Chen from TU Darmstadt. This is the work about FIDO2 analysis. It's a joint work with Manuel Barbosa from University of Porto, Sasha Boldyreva from Georgia Tech, and Bogdan Warinschi from University of Bristol. Most of the work that I did was during my PhD studies at Georgia Tech, working with Sasha.
Let's first look at the motivation. Say you'd like to log into a bank account and check your balance. Now let's see in practice how the security is guaranteed. Typically, server authentication and channel security are guaranteed by some secure channel protocol like TLS with PKI, a public key infrastructure. With PKI, we can assume the bank has a secret signing key and the client has its corresponding public verification key. Then the client can use this key to authenticate the server, and TLS just does this key exchange and build a secure channel. Then to authenticate the user types in its password to the computer or client, which will send the password through the TLS channel to the bank, and the bank will check whether the password is correct or not according to its record. Sometimes we may require the user to have a second factor device for stronger security. It could be a smartphone or could be some secure token that shows a one-time password. Passwords are very easy to use, but it's well known that it has a lot of issues. For example, according to a Verizon report, more than 80% of data breaches are because of password issues. So it's good to get rid of this. To establish passwordless authentication standards, the FIDO Alliance was launched in 2013. FIDO is really a global effort. It involves more than 200 leading companies all over the world. Their proposed protocols have been identified as standards and deployed on important platforms. The usability is also good. For a typical user of FIDO protocols, we only need the user to press a button. The FIDO Alliance currently have three different kind of protocols for authentication. The first one is called U2F. It deals with second factor authentication. The second one, UEF protocol, it does not require a typical password, but still needs the user to provide some biometric feature like his fingerprint. So this essentially is just a strong password. And finally, they have this new FIDO2 protocol that does not involve password in any form, but use the public key credentials to do the authentication. And our work focuses on this new FIDO2 protocol. Let's see how it works. For a typical user of FIDO2 protocol, we need to consider four different parties. We have the human user who wants to log into the server through a client, which may be a browser, and the user owns an authenticator device, which is also called a token. We can assume the human interactions with the token and client to be secure because this just involves physical interactions like pressing a button or browse the internet. FIDO2 has two components. The first one is called Barbosa. It's a web API to handle public key credentials for the authentication. So with this protocol, the authenticator or the token can generate a secret signing key and register the corresponding public verification key to the server. The token is authenticated with a challenge response protocol. So the server generates a random challenge and sends that to the token through the client. Then the token sends the challenge with a secret signing key and responds to the server with a signature. And the server can use the public key to verify the signature and accept this authentication if it's valid. In order to get strong authentication security, FIDO2 also has another component called CTAP2. It's a client-to-authenticator protocol that controls client access to the token, such that only the user-authorized client can have access to it. We'll explain this later, but intuitively, with this CTAP2 protocol, even if the user's token is stolen, the attacker still cannot impersonate the user because it still requires some access to the token. Now we have a basic idea of the FIDO2 protocol. Actually, in its specification, it lists many security goals like user authentication, incubability, denial of service resistance, and so on. But they are all informal. So without formal proof of security analysis, we are not sure what security goals can be achieved. There exists some prior work on the FIDO protocol analysis, but they are either informal or only conducted in the symbolic model. We know that the security in a symbolic model is proved on a machine by some automatic tools, and is much weaker than the security model that we consider in cryptography. And you also notice that the CTAP2 component of FIDO2 has no secretion analysis at all. So it's clear that a comprehensive cryptoanalysis of FIDO2 is highly necessary. And our work will focus on the authentication properties that we think are the most important ones. Now, before going into the details of our analysis, let's see a little bit about our strategy. We analyze the FIDO2 protocol in a modular way. So we first analyze its components and then get the final overall security of FIDO2 from computation result. And we also discuss what security can be achieved if we have a server-to-client authenticated channel, like a TLS channel. Now let's first start with WebAuthn, the first component. We already know that WebAuthn authenticates a token with a challenge response protocol. Actually, a WebAuthn client will first hash the challenge and then send it to the token. So this is how authentication works. Then let's see how to create and register these public key credentials used in authentication. For registration, the token has a so-called attestation key pair embedded in the device by the manufacturer. And the secret key part, A key, never leaves this device. The public key, V key, is carried in a PKI certificate, so we can just assume the server already have that V key. Then just like the authentication, the server first sends a random challenge to the token. Then the token will generate a public key credential. It's a secret and public key pair. Then it will use the secret A key to sign the hashed challenge and generate the public key, and send the public key and the signature to the server. Here we notice that the attestation private key A key is known by the manufacturer, but this generated S key is only known by the token. Then when the server receives the public key and the signature, it will use its verification key V key to verify it, and if the signature is valid, then it will accept this registration and register the public key as a public credential. Now the secret key generated by the token and the public key registered on the server can be later used for authentication. Now we have a full picture of the WebAuthn protocol. Now the question is how to prove its security. In cryptography, we need to first define a general syntax that captures this protocol and its security model. So we call this kind of protocol as passwordless authentication protocol, or PLA protocol. Now let's first look at the protocol syntax. Our PLA protocol captures the kind of authentication protocols that have a challenge response scheme, like WebAuthn. We essentially use general functions to model different behaviors of the parties and use the so-called registration context to model the output credentials. Then the token and server will just use their corresponding registration context to do the authentication. Now we have the full picture of the PLA protocol syntax. Now let's see how to define the security for PLA protocols. To define security, we need to make a common assumption that the token device is tamper-proof. And it turns out that we can consider very strong adversary that can compromise corrupt anything except the token. That's because the secret information is only stored in the token, and all the information that's known by the client and server can be made public. Formally, we see a PLA protocol is secure if for any honest server session that accepts with a credential in registration or authentication is uniquely partnered with a token session that completed with the same credential. Well, in practice, this security implies that only tokens with valid attestation private keys can be registered to the server, and the server only accepts authentication from the token that registers the same credential. Finally, we prove that WebAuthn is indeed PLA secure if the hash function is clearly resistant and the signature is unfoldable. That's all for the WebAuthn analysis. Now let's look at the more complicated protocol, CTAP2. Before showing our analysis, let's take a look at why do we need the CTAP2. So what's missing in WebAuthn? Basically, WebAuthn guarantees a successful authentication is always bound to the registered token, but this may not be bound to the user that owns that token. This makes it possible for an attacker to exploit the user's token to log into another server on behalf of the user. So the attacker just blocks the honest challenge sent to the token and replaces it with a malicious one. It can do this using an online attack waiting for the user to do the authentication, or simply steal the token. So that's why we need to establish client-to-token access channels such that only the user-authorized client can have access to it. In order to build such client-to-token access channels, we also need the help of the user, because we essentially want to bind the token to the user that owns it. Now let's see how Setup2 builds such channels. It has three phases. In the first phase setup, the token is brand new, so the user wants to set it up for his own use. So he first creates a secret user memorizable PIN code and somehow embed the PIN code to the token through the client. So he first types in the PIN code to the client. Then the token and the client will run Diffie-Hellman key exchange to share some secret key. With the shared key, the client encrypts the user PIN with a deterministic encryption scheme that we call CBC0. This is the AES cipher in the CBC mode with 0 IV, and the client will send a ciphertext to the token. In addition to the encrypted PIN, the client also computes the HMAC on the ciphertext and send that to the token. Here we know that the encryption and the MAC use the same key. This is not considered as good practice because the security is not clear. And in our proof, we have to model the HMAC as a random oracle. Finally, the token gets the ciphertext decrypted to the user PIN and store the hash of it. In the second phase that we call binding phase, the goal is to build an access channel from a client that inputs the user PIN to a token that stores the hashed PIN. So to do this, the token generates a random PIN token, PT, and somehow sends that to the client in a secure way. The first part is the same as setup, so they run Diffie-Hellman, and the client sends the encrypted PIN to the token. But now the token will first check whether or not this PIN hash equals the stored one. So this is to guarantee that only the user that owns this token can build such channels. If the PIN check passes, the token will send that encrypted PT to the client, and the client will decrypt it and store that PT. Now in this final phase, we call it access channel phase. It specifies how to use a secret shared PT value to authorize messages sent from the client to the token. The authorization is very simple. The client just uses the PT as a secret key to compute the HMAC of the message and send that to the token. The token will verify that before accepting this message. Now we have the full Setup2 protocol. To analyze the security, again, we need to define its general protocol syntax and security model. We call this type of protocol as a PIN-based access control for authenticators protocol, or PACA protocol. Now let's first look at the protocol syntax. In general, we still have these three phases, and for the first phase setup, in the end, the token will output some static storage that we call it SS. And for the binding phase, the token takes that static storage, and in the end, the token and the client will output some binding state respectively. And finally, for the access channel, the client will use that binding state to generate some authentication tag and send that along with the message to the token for verification. So this is the syntax for our PACA protocol. Now let's see how to define security. For security, we first assume the setup phase to be trusted, because a brand new token can be set up by anyone. So that means we assume the token and client to be communicated in an authenticated channel, which means the adversary can only read but not modify the communication. But the adversary can manipulate the communication of other phases. We also consider a weaker version of our security model to model the security guaranteed by Setup2. In this weaker model, we do not allow the adversary to actively attack the client that inputs the user PIN. This is actually essentially assumed by the Setup2 protocol because they used an authenticated Diffie-Hellman key exchange in the binding phase. And we call this assumption trusted binding. For our PACA security goals, we define a security notion called unforgeability, or UF, to guarantee that the adversary cannot forge new authorized messages to the token. So replay attacks are okay, but the adversary should not be able to create a valid tag for a new message that has never been sent on the established access channel. And we also have a weaker version called UFT to capture the keys with trusted binding assumption. In practice, our security implies that a user's token can only be accessed by the user-authorized clients if the client issued commands are always different with high probability. So for FIDO2, the client issued commands are just random WebAuthn challenges, so they are different with high probability. With our security model, we can prove that CTAP2 is UFT secure in the random oracle model. Here we can see that we require the CBC0 encryption to satisfy some security that we event for this analysis, but it can be reduced to the underlying AES cipher's PRF security. Here we also would like to mention that the security bound we get is not negligible because the pin space has low entropy. So the security bound is similar to the bound in password authenticated key exchange. We also propose several ways to improve the CTAP2 protocol without weakening its UFT security. For example, in the setup phase, because it's trusted, we don't really need the CBC and HMAC. A simple one-time pad would work. And for the binding phase, we can add some simple user confirmation, like pressing a button to exclude all the malicious binding attempts. And finally, CTAP2 also involves several useless reboots that hampers the usability. In the paper, we show that this can be replaced by a simple test of user presence. Now we know that CTAP2 is secure in our UFT model, and it's easy to see that it does not achieve UF security because of the unauthenticated Diffie-Hellman key exchange used in the binding phase. So the natural question is that whether or not we can construct a UF secure protocol. Actually, we can do better. Recall that in the CTAP2 protocol, all the access channels actually share the same binding state, the pin token PT. For security, this means if any of these access channels is compromised by an attacker, then all of the rest channels are not secure anymore. So to achieve stronger security, one may expect all the binding states to be independent with each other. Then even if all the other channels are compromised, it's still possible to get security from the target channel in use. Based on this idea, we can get a stronger security notion that we call strong unforgettability, or SUF, that allows for some compromised channels, and we also have the corresponding notion for the trusted binding keys. Now let's see how to construct strongly unforgettable access channels. To do this, we recall the CTAP2 protocol and see how to improve it to get the strongest SUF security. First, as we said, we can remove the HMAC from the setup. Actually, we can use a one-time pad, but here we just use the CBC. Then for the binding phase, our goal is to first remove this trusted binding assumption. To do this, we observe that actually in the beginning of the binding phase, the token and the client already share some secret information, the hashed pin, so they can use this information to authenticate each other. So here we let them run the password authenticated key exchange protocol with the hashed pin as the shared password to authenticate each other. And another good thing about this PIG protocol is we automatically have independent random binding states. Finally, in the access channel phase, instead of using the same pin token as the binding state, we now use independent random binding states to authorize the messages in different channels. Now, putting them together, we have our generic protocol construction that we call Secure PACA or SPACA. In the paper, we prove that SPACA is indeed strongly secure in the random oracle model if the building blocks are secure and the PIG protocol is secure with explicit authentication. And we have the same remark here, the security bound is not negligible. It's like PIG protocols. We also analyze the performance of our SPACA with IETF standard CPIC at the PIG protocol compared to the CTAP2 protocol. It turns out that our protocol has fewer communication runs and roughly the same computation and communication complexity. So the bottom line here is our protocol is more secure and efficient than the current CTAP2 standard. To summarize our PACA security notions, we first know the simple relations between them, like SUF implies UF, and we know that SPACA achieved the strongest security, and CTAP2 only achieved the weakest one, UFT. In our paper, we also have the separation results that show that UF and SUFT do not imply each other. Now that's all for the CTAP2 analysis. Now let's see the overall security of FIDO2 based on its components. Here we have the FIDO2 protocol with the established client-to-token access channel highlighted. In our paper, we show that the user authentication security of FIDO2 is reduced to the security of its components. So the PLA security of WebAuthn guarantees that accepting server is uniquely partnered with registered token, and PAKA security of CTAP2 guarantees that the PLA partnered token can be only accessed by authorized channels. In practice, this means to impersonate the user to log into the server, the attacker has to get authorized access to the registered token. However, because the CTAP2 protocol only guarantees weak security about the access channels, so we have some limitations here. We have to assume the binding phase is trusted and no access channel to the target token can be compromised. But we show that if the CTAP2 protocol is replaced by our strongly secure PAKA protocol, then we can get rid of all these limitations. Here we still have some subtleties though. If the attacker compromised the channel to the user's token, we know that it cannot access the token through the channel used by the user, but it can block that channel and ensure that the token is accessed by the compromised one. So in this case, we need the user to decline such malicious authentications, so here we require some user gesture to do it. One possible way to do this is to let the user check whether the token actually uses the expected channel. For example, we can let the token and the client to display some human-readable channel ID to the user to check whether they are equal. And for this, we require the token to have a display. Now for the example shown in this graph, we have that the token shows the channel ID to be 2, but the client shows it to be 1, so it does not equal. Then the user can decline this authentication. Now we are quite good with the user authentication part of FIDO2. Now let's see whether or not we can get server authentication. First, we recall that FIDO2 is often run after some secure channel is established. For example, with TLS, we already have server authentication for the client. So the real question here is, does FIDO2 provide user-side server authentication if we have TLS? In our paper, we show that the current standard FIDO2 indeed have user-side server authentication if we have TLS. Actually, this can be any server-to-client authentication protocol. And for this security, we do not need the token to have display, so it can be simply pressing a button. Then, as before, we can improve the security by replacing CTAP2 with our stronger SPAKA protocol. To really achieve security in practice, when some channels are compromised, we require the user to have a gesture to decline the malicious access, like checking the channel consistency. And for this, we require the token to have a display. Now here is a summary of the FIDO2 security. The bottom line here is we have mutual authentication for the FIDO2 protocol if we have TLS, and we have stronger security when the CTAP2 protocol is replaced by our stronger SPAKA protocol. Finally, we'd like to emphasize here why FIDO2 is better than using password and second factor. First, we notice that FIDO2 authentication does not have any password at all, so it does not have those password-related issues like server corruption, phishing, and so on. And low-entropy user pins are only stored in secure tokens and are only attackable in binding phases. And we know that bindings happen much less frequently than authentication sessions, so it's much easier to guarantee security. Okay, now let's summarize our work. So our work analyzes FIDO2's authentication properties. We basically clarify the security guarantees and vulnerabilities and show how to improve its security and efficiency. There are some open problems left. For example, to analyze FIDO's other protocols or FIDO2's other properties, and also construct more efficient, strongly secure passwordless authentication protocols.